Hello, my name is Christina Hendricks, and in this video, I'll be talking about a short discussion of the mythological character of Sisyphus by French philosopher Albert Camus in his longer essay called The Myth of Sisyphus. You've probably heard the story. Sisyphus was condemned by the gods to push a rock up a mountain, only to have it fall back down, and then he had to push it back up, then it fell down, then up, then down, over and over and over, forever. Albert Camus, a 20th century French philosopher, wrote an essay on the myth of Sisyphus, in which he says that the gods, quote, had thought with some reason that there was no more dreadful punishment than futile and hopeless labor. One might disagree that this is the worst possible punishment, but clearly it is pretty awful. Yet Camus also surprisingly says that one must imagine Sisyphus happy. He doesn't just say we can imagine Sisyphus happy, which might be hard enough, but that we must. But why must we? And how, even, can we? Sisyphus was a character in Greek and Roman mythology, a mythical king of Corinth in ancient Greece. There are various versions of his story explaining why the gods punished him so severely. Camus notes several of them in his essay. He expressed a certain, quote, levity towards the gods, end quote, Camus notes, such as in the following examples. In one version of his story, Zeus stole the daughter of Aesopus, a river god, and Sisyphus told Aesopus where she was in return for a fresh water supply for the city. You don't just tell on Zeus and get away with it. But Camus says, to the celestial thunderbolts, Sisyphus preferred the benediction of water. In another version of the story, Sisyphus put Thanatos, the god of death, in chains by tricking him. No one could die. Ares, the god of war, finally released Thanatos. In yet another version, Sisyphus had told his wife that when he died, she should not give him a proper burial in order to test whether she really loved him. When she did as he said, Sisyphus convinced the god of the underworld to let him go back to the world of the living to criticize his wife and get the burial he should have had. When he was allowed to do so, he loved being alive so much he refused to go back to the underworld as he should have. According to Camus, many years more he lived facing the curve of the gulf, the sparkling sea, and the smiles of the earth, until forced back to the underworld by the gods. Camus concludes that Sisyphus was punished in part because of his deep love of life. His scorn of the gods, his hatred of death, and his passion for life won him that unspeakable penalty in which the whole being is exerted toward accomplishing nothing. This is the price that must be paid for the passions of this earth, Camus says. Camus challenges us, I think, to ask ourselves whether we could love life this much. But before you answer, consider that Camus thinks that all human life is as absurd as Sisyphus's task. Could we be as happy as Camus wants us to imagine Sisyphus being?